Arch Crawford combines technical analysis with planetary alignments. He's been at the helm of Crawford Perspectives for over four decades, been able to embrace the new crypto phenomenon, transitioning into this new world post-traditional financial arena and moving into a crypto sphere. In the spirit of rapprochement, we have reconciliation among that crowd in Arch Crawford. Welcome back, Arch.
Delighted to be here.
We were talking, I was stopped in futures contract at 67. I rode that to about 95, 96 on that rebound. You had a similar call around 61, 6200. Give us an idea of what helped you make that decision.
Well, I had some planetary aspects in the December letter, which I thought would, one or the other, would top various and sundry different markets, whether commodities or currencies or stocks or stock groups. And one was December 2nd and the other was December 17th. And I didn't notice that December 17th was a Sunday. I would have probably put, you know, Friday, Monday weekend top. Well, I had it on December 17th as a top for various and sundry markets. And that was Sunday, and it was the top day in the Bitcoin. Then it came down pretty hard. In the January letter, it said it needs another leg down, and then it went down another leg, and then we said it might stop on or about the 618 retracement, and it actually overshot it on the downside a bit, but it popped right back above it within a very short period of time. So then I said, it should probably rally a 50% retracement back up, which would be 6,000 points to 13 to 14,000. And that has yet to happen, but it did pop back up to over 11,000 this week.
I came to a similar conclusion. I just simply took the Fibonacci from the where Bitcoin went parabolic, let's say summer of last year, up to the peak. The low that I was looking for was around the 61.8%. And as you said, it eclipsed that. It went to like 68, almost 70%. Your forecast nearly matches mine within a few hundred points. Blasted back up, we're probably going to hit a 50%, 13,000. I wouldn't be surprised if we didn't try to retest that. I mean, I could easily see 36 to 50,000 by year end, or at least 40,000 by year end.
Well, I think that based on the dollar index, I think is one of the worst looking charts that we have right now. It's forming a huge top pattern that has already come down over 15% and has barely broken out on the downside. And 15% for a currency compared to their trading partners is a huge move. But for the dollar being the reserve currency, it's disastrous, I would think. So now we have a neckline drawn across a head and shoulder top type pattern that has a weak right shoulder, which again is even worse, broke the neckline and has been under it, bouncing up against it for the last 6 or 8 trading days. Today it went back on towards the downside, but it has not broken anything except that neckline. But that is a big deal. And I think it'll go on down from like 90 to 82 in fairly short order. And that could take gold up. It could take the cryptocurrencies up. It could take the silver up and commodities.
That's precisely the argument I think I would have made if I were put on the spot. I mean, the technical position of the greenback is parallel. I don't know if you want to call it a cup and handle, a double top. It reminds me of an end game moment.
That's happening with the dollar index is that the 50-week moving average is just now breaking below the 200-week moving average.
Yeah, it's the inverse of a golden cross. If you've been in the markets long enough, it's almost a self-fulfilling prophecy. You know, I've heard people argue that it's the institutions and the pension funds there. You know, the Titanics, they turn slowly, you might say. They don't tend to make risky decisions. They like to play along with the longer term themes, the 50 under the 200. It's really a rather scientific way of determining the potential trend and they don't like to fight the trend, and they wield considerable power. Once again, Max and Stacy over there at RT on the Kaiser Report, they've been doing some fantastic work in every area, and Stacy, I think it was, brought up an interesting concept, and that was Jamie Dimon making a 180, I guess, on Bitcoin, saying it's very legitimate, and after deeming it worthless, and now he's calling it a material threat to the banking industry. They are, as you may know, fiduciarily responsible when they see a potential threat for their shareholders and stakeholders to make this announcement. They're actually financially liable. He was essentially, you might say, forced to go public with this as an institution. And incidentally, they noted 132 billion ounces of silver physical in their vaults. And keep in mind, just about 8-9 years ago, there was virtually nil in those JP Morgan same vaults. Okay. And then Russia announces right around the same time their bullion holdings. They're stacking 70 pound bars. I counted somewhere in the neighborhood of a few hundred of them, just kind of backing out the image, 70 to $100 million maybe. But in the terms of central banks, it's just a starter allotment.
Technical picture is a triangle. It's an equilateral triangle hitting the top, then hitting the bottom, hitting the top of the trend line, hitting the bottom of the trend line, getting narrower and narrower and narrower. And this, in the last, maybe today or yesterday, it broke down very, very briefly. I've got an hourly chart here, and it bounced right back up into the triangle again. So it's trying to stabilize near the bottom of the triangle, but it's getting near it'll have to be a potential breakout point at some time in the moderately near future.
Exactly. And our friend, and I guess you'd say technical analysis colleague, Clive Mound, I'm sure you've seen some of his work. He has turned bullish, noting that AG, silver, is now at a record gold to silver ratio. You can purchase 80 ounces of silver, nearly a 100 ounce silver bar, for one gold doubloon. And he points out the geochemical breakdown in the Earth's crust. He notes it to be about 20 to 1. Of course, you do the simple back of the envelope math, that gives you a fourfold expected increase. He says $67 to $70 on silver if gold stays stationary. You know, heaven forbid if the actual market forces or Adam Smith's invisible hand is actually allowed to move freely.
Well, I just see the chart pattern is a positive. Of course, the ratio is way out of any kind of historical proportion. So, yes, the silver is probably the better investment, but it's also, both the silver and the gold are a very dangerous trade in that the heavy-duty people are trading and they are watching the chart, and if so many people are respecting a chart, they'll break it and run it. The gold has a historical thing about it.
I've become a Bitcoin believer in the blockchain concept and the freedom that I believe that it potentially has, and the ability to, I think, knock down the walls of this archaic and oppressive, you might even say draconian, monetary system. Give me your back of the envelope thoughts, please.
Present time, I'm not saying anything except that it'll go back halfway up of what it dropped. That's the limit of my explorations with it.
The pattern that could be building up, this sort of consolidation since December, it would seem to imply, again, if those 5,700 lows hold firm, which I think you'd agree they must to maintain a bullish stance. If that were to hold, I can easily just put a Fibonacci projection, as I'm sure you can, on the chart, and that runs you straight to 36 to 40. Mike Novogratz, you may have heard the name, regularly on CNBC. He's a big wig who jumped ship from Wall Street and went crypto crazy. And he went all in at around, I don't know, 4 and then 8,000. And the recent dip, he's gone all in again with big money. He's helping the institutions to find an avenue into this highly illiquid market. He's calling for 40,000 by the end of 2018. Your thought?
It is a wild mover, and it can do anything. It can go to 0 or it can go to 100,000. I would say to anybody, don't bet the farm on it. If you want to gamble with it and it's fun for you, by all means, it may, it's already done it for a lot of people, got in early. So,
you know, someone just echoed your thoughts here. His name is Ivan. He just goes by the name of Ivan on Tech. Arch, if you run into YouTube, you're bored, check out Ivan on Tech. This young fellow, a young developer and a huge crypto enthusiast, and typically don't watch something like this, but he really puts up a great show. From JP Morgan's own desk, on this chart, they juxtaposed the Tulip Mania, Arch, the NASDAQ bubble of 2000, and Bitcoin, a normalized scale. And so you get a true, unadulterated view. The Tulip Mania makes everything else look like a little bump. And Bitcoin makes the Tulip Mania look like an ant underneath the Empire State. If you want to throw a few pennies, a few chips in here, that's great. The folks who made the Buku Bucks, they've long since left the arena. You know, they're driving around in their Lambos. We've just recently had a big event in the VIX. I mean, to me, the VIX is behaving kind of similarly to every other time the U.S. equities got too far ahead of themselves. It's after virtually no spike in a couple of years, I would expect volatility at some point to have an explosion. That doesn't sound like manipulation to me, but unfortunately, some of the folks involved in the short VIX, I think this was the XIV, it dropped about 90 to 95%, the ETFs there. Give us your view, your take on U.S. equities.
Well, the VIX, after being the lowest in history for the longest period of time in history, finally broke up through some long-term trend lines and some long-term resistances and blew up to 50 bucks in a day and a half or so. I had posted everywhere the date of the top of the market plus one, but I posted it all the top of the market minus two on several places, including LinkedIn, Facebook, Google, MarketWatch, and whatever other places I could think of, that there was a huge planetary alignment on the 25th of January, and that I thought it would have a big effect, including on a big drop in the markets. It topped the next day. Of course, the biggest down was, I think, February the 5th, which I also wrote up in the newsletter. The flash crash back in 2010 was on, I think, May the 6th, and this was on February the 5th, and those two dates have something in common. They are both the middle date between an eclipse, an equinox, and a solstice. W.D. Gann wrote, the only thing I ever heard him mention about astronomic things, I watched the equinoxes and solstices and the middle date between them, turning points and large changes. That's what we got both on that flash crash.
I just can't point out enough to people, instead of speculating, you know, all in these markets, I like Nassim Taleb. I guess it's a broken record now. His barbell theory, one interpretation would be, well, you might buy way out of the money puts each week, let's say, during these extremes, and maybe it's 0.1% of your portfolio. The other 99% held in safe, diversified bonds and equities funds and things like that, little Bitcoin spread across the spectrum. Buy these way out of the money puts, and before you know it, you've lost almost everything you were investing until that January peak and crash, and then you've doubled your money from that one investment.
Well, I'm going to be promoting the idea that my work has done best on volatility than anything else. And I've been the best predictor of volatility in the market for 40 years. To crash when I was working at Merrill Lynch as a technical analyst.
Well, hat tip for you. And, you know, we have Ralph Acampora scheduled for tomorrow, a featured guest with Ralph Acampora this weekend. We're in the cycle. Do you see volatility now? Do you agree, you know, we could see another spike or so, and we might even see an uptrend for a longer period of time?
Well, we had such low volatility for so long, it was clear to me when it was going to happen because of the planets. And when we start building volatility, I have predicted the date of the worst crash, like five times out of five, from planets.
And so do you see further volatility ahead?
I do not have it pinned down closely or accurately at this time. What I'm saying is that I would not be surprised at all to see a retest of the lows before we go higher into late April, early May.
What they're saying over at RT, citing analysts who are calling for the market to remain a bit aloft as we move into the November elections, that tends to be a surprisingly bullish cycle. Any thoughts there as we wrap up?
The normal cycle is that the administration does what it can to hype the market up in the last month going into the election period. I don't know if they will try to crash it to get rid of him. I mean, you know, the swamp is fighting back.
The swamp doesn't want to be drained.
That's right. I'm looking for some more difficulty around the eclipses of July and August. And after that, I will be depending on the technical analysis to keep up with the trend that it most closely matching.
Tell people about the services you provide, please.
I have a newsletter that's been on the market for 40 years now. It's the same price it was in 1977, which is $250 a year. It's 4 pages a month. It's fairly concise. It has charts and easy explanations, but it is based on technical market analysis largely, and with planetary cycles thrown in as the gravy.
We appreciate that special Crawford Perspective sauce. Talk soon, Arch.
Oh, sure. Delighted to be here.